I was recently challenged to create this scroll-based animation you can see from the logical.so site, and at first when I saw this I was blown away with how cool this looks, but as I started to analyze it some more I realized that this is actually much easier than it looks. And in this video I'm going to show you how you can create this entire effect using just 100 lines of code, almost entirely CSS, and most importantly I'm going to walk you through my thought process of how I go about seeing this problem and then developing a solution for it. So I'm going to break down step by step everything I went through as I was building out this solution so you can really see how you can actually look at something like this and build it yourself. Welcome back to Web Dev Simplified. My name is Kyle and my job is to simplify the web for you so you can start building your dream project sooner. And today I'm going to show you how to create this scroll-based animation, but I'm not just going to show you how to create this. I'm actually going to walk you through step by step the exact thought process I went through from the moment I saw this to all the way building this entire project. So you can really see how I approach looking at something complex like this, breaking it down into pieces and figuring out what is actually happening here. So the main things I focused on in this video are going to be the actual pop-up of this image right here, so you can see this popping up, as well as the fading in of new images, as well as the fact that as I start to scroll my page, you'll notice I'm scrolling my page, but nothing at all is moving. It's not actually scrolling. Other things are happening, like the background is fading and so on. So handling that is the other thing I focused on. If we look at the version that I have built here, you can see I removed a lot of these floating elements. That's because to build those, it's the exact same process as everything else in this video. It's just copy-pasted, so it's really boring to show all of those at once, since it's exactly the same thing. But as you can see, I can start to scroll my page and nothing happens except for this image grows larger and my background starts to fade in color. And once I hit far enough, you can see everything starts scrolling in. And as I get down, you can see my different images are jumping in. So it's essentially working exactly the same. The only thing that's missing is some of these flyaway elements right here. Now to get started for this project, I actually do have a little bit of starting code. So if we look at the HTML here, you can see I have some HTML that's essentially just laying out my code. You can see I have this top section with some text inside of it. And when I shrink it down, you can see it becomes full screen. I'd have the two different background colors. And then down here, I have the rest of my entire application. It's super straightforward stuff. So really simple HTML. And I have a little bit of CSS. The main thing this CSS is doing, just the important stuff, is we're setting the background color for our entire site to be this color right here. And this left and right section actually are their own things and they have their own background color. So you can see the left-hand background color is pretty much white and this right hand is a gradient that's this dark gray color. I copied all of these values exactly from the logical site. So if I expand this here, I just essentially inspected the page like this and I went over and I looked inside of the source and everything and found the exact styles of what all the different colors they used were, same with the font sizes and so on. So I just put the exact same text and everything in place. I also have here a media query that just shrinks everything down. So as you can see, when I get to a small enough size, you can now see it's on one page, and that's exactly what they have here as well. The only other thing that I have is essentially every single section on this page is 100 VH, so it's exactly as tall as my viewport. And you can see if I scroll up here, I've essentially set them all to a height of 100 VH. Other than that though, there's no JavaScript code and there's nothing at all that's handling all these different scroll-based animations. I essentially just have the boilerplate section of the code that we have. And I also have the images downloaded from their site as well. So I'm just going to be using three of the images just to kind of show you what it looks like across three different sections. Now, the very first thing I did when I actually saw this animation is I went to the site. I just spent a lot of time really slowly scrolling, like one scroll wheel take at a time to really see what was happening. And I noticed, okay, I scrolled a little bit and the only thing that changed is the screw in the background started to fade and so on. And you kind of could see, okay, there's some stuff going on when I do that. And then I just noticed that they had delays on the scroll essentially. So clearly this section at the top had to be fixed in place. That's the only way to make something stay in place when you scroll. And sure enough, when I actually inspected the page and looked at what they were doing here, this top section up here is actually stuck in place. If we open this up, you can see it has a position of fix. So it is stuck in place and that's how they're getting that to work. And you'll notice as I start to scroll, the actual translate property is what's changing. So they're just moving it manually with the translate property based on the actual scroll wheel. And they're doing all of this inside of JavaScript just because as I can see they're setting the style manually. So clearly this is all happening inside of JavaScript. So already I got a bit of an idea. They're just hooking up a scroll event listener and they're changing the translate property based on how far they have scrolled on the page. That's not too terribly complicated. And that's essentially how they're doing all of these different elements in this top section. Then I scrolled down a little further to figure out how this section worked. And this is really interesting. You'll notice that once I essentially hit a certain trigger, the image jumps in and out. So essentially what they're doing is they're checking for when you hit a certain part of the page, move in one image and hide the other image. And that is really easy to do with an intersection observer. That's exactly what the intersection observer is actually meant for. I have a full video covering that if you want to check it out. I'll link it in the cards and description for you. But essentially, it's just a way to figure out if an element is on the page or not. And that's a great way to do these kind of like proximity-based animations, as you can see like this. So already, the two main animations on the page, I already have an idea how they're doing them. The first one, they're listening to the scroll event to figure out how far the page has been scrolled, and the other one is just a really simple intersection observer. And my idea with this project is I wanted to do as much as I could inside of CSS. I essentially wanted to have the least amount of JavaScript code possible. Because in this project, they're doing essentially every single thing in JavaScript. Because as you can see, as you scroll, all these different styles are changing. I essentially wanted my JavaScript to do absolutely nothing other than set the bare minimum properties, and then everything else would happen in CSS, just because I thought that would be more fun and a little bit more of a challenge. So now let's actually try to build this out. We have an idea of how they're doing these different things, so let's start to actually implement these different ideas. Now, the very first thing that I want to do is I want to figure out how far we have scrolled in the page. And the really interesting thing is we only care about at the very top of our page. That's the only place where we actually care about how far we have scrolled on the page, because if we expand this a little bit more, you'll notice this is the only time we do that weird scroll-based animation. Everything else, like I mentioned, is based on intersection observers. So all I need to know is how far have I scrolled along the first page, essentially the first height of my screen, how far have I scrolled on that between 0 and 100%. So if we go into our JavaScript, let's just create a simple function to do that. We'll call this setScrollVar, and what this is going to do is it's going to set a custom property in our CSS, and we can use that to do everything else that we need to. So what we can do is we can come into here, I'm going to create an HTML element here, and this is just going to be our actual HTML element. So we can say that we want to get the document element from our document. That's going to be the actual HTML tag right here. That's what we're selecting because I want to be able to get the height of that. That'll give me the height of essentially one page of my document. So what I can do here is I can say that I want to get the percent of screen height scrolled, a very long variable name, but I prefer to be a little bit more descriptive. And what we want to do is we're going to take that HTML element, and what I want to do is I want to get the scroll top. What that's going to give me is it's going to give me the pixels of the very top of my page. Like how far have I scrolled? That's what it's going to give me, is the pixels of how far down I have scrolled. Then what I want to do is I want to divide that by the HTML element dot client height. And the client height is essentially just how tall my window is. So all I'm doing right here is I'm figuring out how far have I scrolled down in pixels versus how tall is one screen of my website. And when this value is equal to 1, or essentially 100%, that means that I have scrolled exactly one page worth of my website. And when it's at 0, it means I'm at the very top. 50% is going to be in the dead center of the first page. And if I've scrolled two whole pages, it's going to be at 2, essentially 200%. So this value is essentially going to be between 0 and however many pages I have. In my case, since I only care about how far I've scrolled on the first page, I really only care about this value between 0, meaning I haven't scrolled, and 1, meaning I've scrolled all the way past the very first page. So what we can do here is I can just create a variable. We'll say HTML element.style.setProperty. This allows me to set a CSS property. We're going to call this scroll, and that's going to be our scroll percentage between 0 and 100. And to get this, what I want to do is I want to get my percent of screen scrolled. I already know that's going to be between 0 and whatever my number is. So 0 to 1 is going to be 0 to 100. So I'm going to multiply this by 100. That way my value will go between 0 and 100 instead of 0 to 1, because I don't really want to deal with decimals. I want to deal with actual percentages. And then what I want to do is I just want to make sure I get the minimum value of this, because I never want it to go above 100. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, give me the minimum of either the value 100 or this multiplied together. And the reason I'm doing that is because as I scroll further and further down my page, I don't really care about this value growing and growing and growing. I want it to always go between 0 and 100. That is the range that this value goes. 0 again, meaning I haven't scrolled, and 100 meaning I have scrolled exactly one page of my website. And that is all it takes to create this actual function. So now we can hook up a few event listeners to actually listen to this. So let's just go to the very top of our page. We're going to set up a window event listener. So we're going to add an event listener. This one's going to be for scroll. And what we can do is come in here and we're going to set the scroll variable. Now, another thing that's really important is if we resize our page, we also want to make sure things work, because there's actually a bug on this site. You'll notice if I go full screen here, and you'll notice this image is no longer down here. You can see if I scroll to this section, the image is right here, everything's working fine. And now if I scroll to be larger, you can see the image disappears. And as soon as I scroll, it reappears, even though it's supposed to be there. So there's actually a bug in the current site, the one that we're actually basing this off of, because they don't listen to resize of your window. They only listen to your scroll event. So we want to also copy this and listen to resize as well. That way, if your window size changes, it'll also make sure to properly set your scroll, because if you resize your window, obviously your scroll depth has probably changed. Now, the final thing I want to do is I want to make sure when I load my page, I also call this. And that's because if you scroll partially through a page and then you refresh it, a lot of times what happens is it tries to preserve where you are in the scroll. So we want to make sure we actually set our scroll variable based on where we are on the page. And just having this right here, make sure that it's going to set it if it refreshes our scroll to be somewhere else. else based on when we refresh our page. Now, the final thing I want to do to deal with this scroll variable is go into my CSS, and I'm just going to come down to the very bottom here, and I want to select the root element. That is my HTML element, and I want to default my scroll here to 0. Just because in case for some reason our JavaScript fails or something goes weird, I want to make sure this always has a default value of 0. That way, at least no matter what, all of my animations and everything will just start in their default state. Now with that done, let's actually see if what we've done has done anything. I'm going to come in here and I'm just going to do a quick console log. So we're just going to say console.log. I'm just going to copy all this code, essentially what we're doing to set our variable. I'm going to paste that in here. I'm going to see what this actually logs out. So if we inspect our page, go over to our console, you can see right now it's logging out 0. And as I scroll, you can see this value is increasing. And once I've scrolled one full page, which is where this gray line is, you can see it's at 100. And as I go further and further, you can see it's always staying at 100. It's never going above that because we have it capped with that math.min. Then what we're doing, if we get back up here, you can see it goes between 0 and 100. So we have a value in our CSS that is now being set, and it will always have a value between 0 and 100 based on how far we have scrolled along this very first page. So now let's go ahead and actually implement this. I'll expand my screen a little bit so we actually have it looking like the full screen version, because that's, in my opinion, the cooler version to work on. And what we need to do is we need to essentially position this sticky so it won't move when we scroll. That's relatively easy to do. If we go to our HTML, I gave this a class of top section right here. So you can see we can select that top section class, and then I can just set the position here to sticky. And now if I make sure, let's just say the top is going to be 0, because we want to stick it to the top of our page. Now as I scroll, you'll notice this is just staying in place no matter what. And if I want to move it, I could use the translate property. For example, I can translate -10%, and now it's going to move itself up 10%. And that's because it's 100% of the screen size. So 10% of its own height is 10% of the screen size. So if I change this to -100, you can see it's completely disappeared. While if I changed it to 50, it's half off the page. So what we need to do is we need to animate this property to essentially go between 0 and 100. But the interesting thing is we don't want this to actually start moving until we have started scrolling on our page for a little bit. Because as you can see, if I start to scroll here, you'll notice that this top section doesn't move until I get quite a ways down my page. So what I need to do is I need to make sure I take that into account and only start moving this up after I've actually scrolled for a little bit. But I want to speed up the rate that this moves up based on my scroll, because I want it to get out of the way before this bottom section comes in. Because as you can see, this top section here is actually moving faster than this bottom section. As you can see, the gap between these two pieces of text actually grows as I scroll down. And that's because I want this to speed up to actually take into account the fact that it paused for a while at the beginning. This sounds really complicated, but it's actually fairly easy to do with just a little bit of math. Essentially, what I want to do is I want to convert one range of values to another range of values. Because for example, I want this to start moving when I'm about 25% of the way scrolled through my page. And I want it to go from 0 to 100 within the span that my scroll goes from 25 to 100. So we can use a simple formula I'm going to copy over here. And this formula essentially is saying, let's just shrink this down. We're going to take the old values that we have, the old values being my scroll values. So my old value right here, this is just whatever my scroll percentage is. And I know that my range of scroll percentages goes from 0 to 100. But in my case, I only want to start scrolling at 20. So my minimum value here is going to be 25. So we have 25 is our min, and that's our old min. Let's just write that out, old min, there we go. Our new range is going to be between 0 and 100 because I want to start the translate at 0% and I want to move it to -100. So we know that our new range is 100. There we go. Our old range is between 25 and 100. So that is 75 wide. So we can say 75 is equal to our old range. And then what we can do is we can add in our new minimum, and our new minimum is 0. There we go. And our old value here, that's just our scroll variable. So our variable for scroll right here, that is what our old value is equal to. So all we need to do is plug these values into a formula. And what it's going to do is it's going to convert our scroll value, which is between 25 and 100, and convert it to a range of 100 to 0, which is much better for how we want to do this. It'll essentially speed up our scroll as we go. So we want to translate, and we want to do essentially a massive calculation. The first thing is we want to get our scroll variable. But right now, this scroll variable actually goes from 0 to 100. Instead, we want it to go from 25 to 100. So we can actually use a really simple trick here where we get the maximum value between our scroll and the value 25. And what this little bit of code is doing right here is it's saying, okay, give me the maximum of either how far I've scrolled down my page or 25. which means 25 is the lowest number that this will ever return from us, and we know our scroll never gets larger than 100, so this will actually give us a range of values between 25 and 100, and that's because, by default, our very initial value for our scroll is going to be 0, but this will return 25 since 25 is larger than 0, and as we scroll, until we get larger than 25% of the way down our page, this will always return 25. So this code for our max, that essentially is our old value. Now what we want to do is we want to plug in our old minimum, so we can just subtract 25 from this, make sure I put that parenthesis back in there. So now, by default, this is essentially going to subtract out to 0 until we scroll 25% of the way down our page, which is perfect. That means it will not move until we get to that 25% of the way cutoff. Then what I want to do is I want to wrap this in parentheses because I want to make sure that this does all its calculations before my next multiplication comes in. My new range we know is 100, so I'm going to plug that in. Our old range here is 75 because it goes from 100 to 25. And then our new min is 0, so we don't need to add anything at all. Now this right here is going to give us a number, but we need to convert this to a percentage, and to do that inside of CSS, all you do is multiply by 1 and whatever the unit is. So 1% multiplied by this will turn this into a percentage, but this is actually going to move us the wrong direction. It's going to translate us down. We want to translate up, so if we use a negative number here instead, it's now going to translate us up. So let's just remove all this code right here. We'll keep this formula in just so you can actually see it. And if I give this a quick save and I move over here, you'll now notice as I start to scroll, nothing moves. But if I get far enough, you can see this top section moves, and you'll notice it's moving faster than the bottom section, which is exactly what we want. And as soon as we get 100% of the way down, you can see it completely disappears off the top of our screen. So already our top section is doing exactly what we wanted to, which is really great. The only other thing we need to do is make it so our background fades in and out, because right now if we look and we expand this a little bit, you can see that these backgrounds actually fade in, and they start fading immediately when you scroll, and then maybe when you get about halfway to a third of the way down the page, they become fully transparent. And the reason that these backgrounds, when they become transparent, turn into this darkish gray color is because on the body, we have actually set our background color to that gray color. So by making these two backgrounds right here completely transparent, we are essentially saying that we want them to become gray. So now I essentially want to do the exact same thing I did with that formula, but I want it to be a little bit different. Instead of starting at a minimum value of 25, I want this to start at a minimum value of 0, but I want it to go to a maximum value of, like, let's say 30%, because once I'm 30% of the way scrolled, my actual background should be the same color as the rest of my page. So what we can do is we can create a CSS variable. I'm going to call this background opacity. There we go. And I want to do essentially the exact same thing I did here with my calculation, but I want to change it around a little bit, obviously. So instead of having a minimum value of 25, I want to have a maximum value of 30. To do that, we need to change this to be min, and then change this over here to be 30. And essentially what that is saying is give me the minimum value of whatever my scroll is, or 30. So it'll never become larger than 30, and my scroll never becomes larger than, or smaller than 0, because 0 is the smallest that it can be. So now if we take a look at our old formula here, we have our old value, that's this minimum section. Our old minimum is 0, because we don't have any minimum value other than our scroll itself, so we can actually remove the subtract by 25 because we have no minimum. Our minimum is 0. Our new range is still 0 to 100, so we're going to multiply by 100, and our old range is just from 0 to 30. So instead of being 75 here, our range is now only 30 units wide, and our minimum is still 0, so we're going to keep that as is. So now if we real quick look at this formula, essentially what I have done is I've taken the value between 0 and 30, and I've converted it to the range of 0 to 100. But that's actually the reverse of what we want, because instead of going between 0 and 100% opacity, I want to go from 100% to 0. Because right now, if we change this to be multiplied by 1%, this will give us a range of 0 to 100%. And we can see if we apply this background opacity to all of our different colors by just putting it as the fourth property to the RGB function, and we come over to our page, you notice our background starts gray, and as we scroll, it actually fades into the color that we want to get rid of. So instead, we need to inverse this. So we can just take 100, and we can just come in here like this, 100%, and we want to subtract that from 1% times this. So essentially, this is going to be giving us a value of 0 to 100, and we want to just inverse that by subtracting from 100% here. So now you can see my opacity starts out correct, and as I scroll down, you can see it starts to fade out. And if you look at the very bottom of our page, you can see that there's still a little bit of difference between these two colors, and then one more scroll down, and now you can see it's all exactly the same color because it is completely faded out. Now if I change this 30 here to be 50, for example, now what's going to happen is it's going to fade out over 50%. So as you can see, there's a little bit longer time period between when the background starts fading and when it finished fading out. In my case, 30% I think is about as close to what they actually have on their website as we can get, so that's why I stuck with 30%. And that right there covers the entire top section of our animation other than the actual image. And this is how they do all the other images on the top section. As you can see, all of these different images, they just move based on how far you've scrolled. And some of them move more, some of them move less. They just take this formula right here and just do different things with it. So they're doing different translate properties, X and Y, based on what different scales they want. So they use this exact same formula for all of these different sections. And that's why I'm not going to be doing all of them, because they all use the exact same technique. It's just going to be tweaking numbers, and that's not super fun to watch. So the very first thing I want to do, if we just come back here, you'll notice as I scroll down, this completely visual section down here actually comes in quite a bit, you know, quicker than we want it to. We don't want it to be here so quickly. So instead, I'm going to add a little bit of padding to this section to make it so it doesn't show up quite so soon. And if we go over to our HTML, you'll notice here that this very first section, I gave a class of first main section. So we can just use that selector. And what we can do is we can just say that we want some padding on the top. And let's say in our case, we want it to be 10% of the screen, so 10VH. That's just going to push that section down a little bit more, which is going to make it so it doesn't come in quite so close to our top section, which is pretty much exactly what we want. That looks really good. So now we can go ahead and move on to the actual image section, because right now I'm not working on this image, but as you can see, they have that image that grows in place and then fades out with the other images on the page. The first thing I'm gonna work on is the growing in place, because that is again a scroll-based animation, just like everything else we've done, but of course it's slightly more complicated than some of the other ones because it's growing in multiple different dimensions. So the very first thing I wanna do to get started is just style all of our images just like this, so they're in like their final state, and then we'll go through and add all the CSS for the different animations, for example, this starting state, as well as the animation between these two different styles. And actually, let's move into our HTML so we can do our images. Now our images, I'm just going to be displaying absolutely over the top of our page. So we're just gonna give them essentially a div here. We're gonna call this images. And inside of here, I'm gonna put each one of my images. So we're gonna have an image. The source is going to come from our images folder. So you can see we have image 1, 2, and 3. So I'm just gonna say images slash image1.png, just like that. Then we can give them some different classes. So I'm gonna come in here for this one. This one's going to be different than all the other images. So I'm gonna give this a top section image class. And I'm also gonna give it the show class, because we want this to obviously be the shown image, while all of our other images we want to be hidden by default. So image 2, for example, we're not gonna give it any classes because by default it's just going to be hidden. And then we'll come in here with image 3 as well. So here you can see we have our image, it's massive, it doesn't look very good. So let's go over to our CSS and actually start styling this out. I can select all of our images just by getting the things inside that images folder. I'm gonna say star to select every single child inside of it. And here is where we're going to do the position of fix, so it's always in the same place on our screen. And the width here is going to be 100VW. Lastly, I'm just gonna set the bottom to be 0, and then we'll give it a Z index of 10, just so it shows up over top of our top section. And now you'll notice we have our image on the bottom. Now, one interesting thing to note about this is I gave it a width of 100VW, but it doesn't actually span the full width. That's because these images actually have some empty space on the sides. If I open it up, you'll see all this checkerboard mark around the image is just empty space, but the image is still actually there. So it's larger than the actual image that's showing up inside of it because it has all this transparent space around it. That's why we can give it a width of 100 and it doesn't actually touch the sides of the page, which is nice and easy to use. Finally, what I want to do is by default hide all the images. And the way these images animate in is they actually pop in from the bottom, as you can see here. I'll just get rid of my camera so it's a little easier for you to see. There we go. We got that pop-in style showing up. So what we want to do is by default hide them all by pushing them to the bottom of the screen. We can do that really easily with the translate property. So we'll say translate, and we want to translate them by 100%. That's going to push them down essentially their entire height, so they're hidden. Again, if we change this to like 50%, you can see they're half visible and so on. Then what I want to do is I just want to animate on this property. So I can say that we're going to transition on the translate property. And that translate property, we want it to animate for 250 milliseconds, and we're gonna do ease in and out. And then for our images, we want to make sure that if we have the class of show, that our translate is essentially going to be 0, 0. So that way it's actually visible to us. And now if we save, you can see, if we just give it a quick save again, we kind of have the animation showing up a little bit. That's just because of the hot reloading, but you can see that our main image is showing, which is exactly what we want. And all of our other images are currently hidden because they're just pushed off the screen. They're still there, they're just pushed off the screen so we can't see them. So now let's actually go about and try to animate this top image just like we want it to. Because right now you can see it's already too large. We essentially need this top image to start out at a 50% width. Because if we look at here, if I scroll to the top and make this just a little bit bigger, you can see that this image starts out essentially at 50% of the screen size, and then it grows to 100% of the screen size. So we need to do that animation. And we can do that by coming in here. It's going to be inside of our images folder, and we want to get the top section image. So again, I want to use that exact same formula. I'm just going to copy this over, paste it in here so we can take a look at it. We need to figure out what our old values are going to be. That's our scroll values. And if we look at this, you'll notice about when we get to 30% scrolled, essentially when our background becomes entirely opaque or entirely transparent, you'll notice that's when this is essentially fully grown. So we can essentially use the exact same scale that we used up here for this. So let me just copy this entire thing right here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to paste this in. I'm going to set a CSS variable for value just to figure out what that value is. So right here, what we're saying is we have a value that is going to be a maximum of 30. So it's going to be 0 to 30. So our old value is always 0 to 30 right here. That's that minimum right here. Our old minimum is 0, so we don't have any of that. We're multiplying by our new range, which is 0 to 100. In our case, we're actually going to change this to 50, and I'll tell you why in just a second. Our old range here is going to be 0 to 30. That's where this says 30, and our new minimum is still 0. Now, the reason that we're changing this to 50 is because by default, our image starts out at 50% width, and we only want it to grow all the way up to 100. So we want it to grow from 50 to 100. That's why this value only goes up to 50, because I'm going to start it by default at 50. So what we can do is we can actually set the width of our image here with a simple calculation. We're going to say 50 VW is our default width here, and then we're going to multiply it by 1 VW times our value, which is going to be var value, just like that. The reason I'm doing this multiplication here is to convert this value, which is just 0 to 50, to an actual unit, which is VW. So now it's going to be 0 to 50 VW. So by default, this is going to start at 50 VW width. And as we scroll up to 30%, it's going to grow all the way to 100% size. So we come all the way back here, you can see it starts at that 50% width. And as I scroll, you can see it's growing and growing until it gets to full size, and then it stays there. And again, it shrinks back down. And the nice thing is you can see that growing happens before the actual scrolling of this top section. All these pieces are starting to come together. Now, the final thing we need to do is if you look over here, when we scroll to the top, you'll notice the image is actually pushed down. And as we scroll, it starts to come up and grow in size. So we also need to modify our translate as well. So we can come in here and we could modify our translate by doing this, and then we could set our translate. But you'll notice we've already set our translate on our image. We want to essentially translate it, but we don't want to modify this translate that's already there. Normally, this would be incredibly difficult to do, but in CSS, there's actually two ways to modify translate. We can do translate, or we can do the transform translate. So I can say here, I want to translate in the Y direction, not the Z direction, the Y direction. And now I can actually translate two different ways, and it's going to both apply. So it's really nice that both of these are going to work, and it's going to make it so I don't have to modify any of this code. It'll work just fine. And then I have this separate translate here for this specific animation. So I'm going to do the exact same calculation here. Essentially, I'm going to start at 50%, but in this case, it's going to be percent instead of VW, and I'm going to, you know, animate up to 100%. So by default, you can see it's mostly hidden, essentially looks exactly like this does over here. And then as I scroll down, it's actually growing. That's because this should be minus instead of positive, because I want it to go to zero. There we go. So now you can see as I scroll down, it grows upward by translating upward, and it also grows in width by growing from 50% to 100%. So that's giving us two different ways that this is animating using the exact same value, so it looks really smooth and good. So right now we have the entire top section of this animation essentially the same, minus all the stuff that we decided not to implement. The next step is going to be this essentially intersection observer we want to do. So essentially, once we hit a certain percentage of the way scrolled through the page, we want to trigger this animation. And the easiest way to do this with an intersection observer is actually going to be to set up an element that has essentially zero height. So it's always going to only show up once we cross a specific point on the page. I want to put that element in there. And then as soon as that element becomes part of the page, then what I want to do is I want to toggle this animation. So what we can do inside of our HTML is inside of each one of our sections, I'll just expand this. You can see we have a section. Each one of these sections, we can put at the very bottom of it, essentially just a really simple div. And this div, we're gonna give a single attribute here, data image to show. Now, the reason I'm doing that is because we can use this data attribute both in our CSS and our JavaScript to select this, but we can also give it a value. For example, if I want to select image one up here, I can say that my data image to show is going to be image one. So I'm going to be selecting something with the ID image one. And up here, I'm going to give this an ID, which is image one, just like that. Same thing with the other one, I'm gonna give image two, and we're gonna give it image three. There we go. So this is going to be for showing image one. Down here, this section is going to be for showing image two, and this final section here is going to be for showing image three. So essentially what I'm going to do is as soon as one of these divs shows up on my page, I want to show that image and hide all of the other images. And if we kind of take a look at how this works, you'll notice when we get about 20% of the way down the page, that's when essentially it happens. So like 20% of the way before we start to see the next page is when the scroll happens. So I guess when we've scrolled 80% of the way through the page, that's when this happens. So what we can do is we can come in here, we can select that data attribute, which is data image to show. I can position this absolutely. So I can say position absolute, just like that. And what I want to do is I want to set the top to be 20%. So now once my page is essentially 20% on the screen, that's when it's going to do this different trick over to the next image, just like that. So you can see that this text is about 20% on the page. It's currently behind the image, which is why you can't see it. But if I were to actually just delete this image real quick, come up here to all these images, delete them, you'll notice that this is about 20% of the way on the page. So as soon as this element is 20% of the way on the page, this thing will show up because we positioned it absolutely at 20%. All we need to do is make sure that the container that it's inside of, the actual full screen sections up here, they're going to be a position of relative. That way the absolute position goes inside of it. So now what we can do is we can really quickly, I'm just going to do this for testing purposes. We're going to say height 100 pixels, width 100%, background red, so we can actually see what this looks like. So now if we come over here and I scroll down, you can see at essentially 20% of the way through our page, we have these red rectangles showing up. So as soon as these red rectangles show up on our page, that is when we're going to animate in the new image. And that is looking like it'll be perfect for our use case, because you can see as I scroll down, if I make this a little bit bigger, as I scroll down, you can see that that red bar is showing up. So this image is there. And as soon as the next red bar shows up, that's when my image would swap out. So it's swapping out right before the text shows up on the page, which is exactly what we want. So now let's just go ahead and get rid of those CSS styles, because I only want these. That way it's essentially a zero width, zero height element. It's just going to be on the page and the intersection observer is smart enough to know when this shows up, deal with it. So instead of our JavaScript, let's set up an intersection observer for this. We're going to say const observer equals new intersection observer. And again, if you're unfamiliar with how intersection observer works, I have a full video on it. I'll link in the cards in the description. I even have a blog article on it. I'll link down in the description for you as well. So what we want to do is we want to observe different things, and it's going to call this function based on what happens for the things that we observe. So what I can do is if in my document, I want to query select all of the different elements that have that data attribute of image to show. And then I'm just going to loop through these. So I'm going to say for each one of these sections that we have, what I want to do is I want to observe this section. So I can say observer.observe the section. There we go. So we're just observing that div that is 20% of the way through our page. Then what we can do inside of this observer is I want to loop through all of my different entries. So I'm just going to say let I equal entries.length minus 1, and I is greater than or equal to 0, and I minus minus. The reason I'm doing this is I'm looping through bottom to top just to make sure if there's ever a case where two things were on the screen at the same time. It shouldn't happen, but if they were, it'll always make sure that the one that's on the bottom, which is the one that we scrolled the furthest down to get, is going to be the first one that we trigger. Then what I want to do is I want to get the entry here. That's just going to be from our entry array, the ith element. And then I want to say if entry dot, whoops, entry dot is intersecting, that means it is on the page. So if it is on the page, then what we want to do is we want to show the image associated with that. So I can come in here, I can do my query selector all to hide all of the original ones. So I want to get all the images to show. And actually here, I just want to get the data image. And this is a data attribute I'm going to add to each one of my images. So for all my images, I'm going to add a data attribute of data image. Just going to paste that down like that. So now they all have their own data attribute. I'm selecting all of them right here. And what I want to do is I want to hide all of them. So for each image, what I want to do is I want to take my image class list and I want to remove that show class. So this is saying as soon as one of my red rectangles shows up on the screen, hide all of the images. Then we're going to show only the image that is actually being scrolled onto. And we can get that image based on that data attribute. So we can say document.querySelector, and I want to get the entry, which is the actual thing that's showing. I want to get the target, which is the HTML element. From the data set of that target, I want to get that image to show. So what this is going to do for us is it's going to grab whatever string we put inside of this data attribute. So it's going to give us either image 2, image 3, or image 1. And by doing a query selector, we're actually going to find the specific image that we need. Then we can just say that we want to take the image. It's possible the image is null, so I'm going to put a question mark here. It shouldn't ever be null, but it is possible. And I'm just going to add the show class to that. And then I'm going to break out of my loop, just like that, so that we don't actually do anything else inside of this loop. And that right there should be everything we need to actually hide and show our images. So if I increase this a little bit, We'll just refresh our page, scroll to the top. You'll notice as I scroll down, this first image is showing, everything's fine. And then as soon as I get down to the section where the second image should show up, it shows up. If I scroll back up, you can see the first image shows up. So it's actually working where it's transferring between the different images. Same thing with the third image. It's showing up just fine and it's properly going back to the second. Same thing here, and it's actually shrinking down my first image, which is exactly what I want. So this is really, really great. Really, there's only one last thing we need to do, and we need to make sure that when we're on a smaller screen size, that this right here fills the full width. So that's really easy to do. I already have a media query for handling this, so I just want to get the images. I want to get the top section image, and I want to set the width here to 100 VW. That way it's always going to be that specific 100 VW width. But I want to make sure that this comes after this selector right here, just so it's actually going to make sure it applies. So now if we paste that down up here, give that a save, you can now see that this is 100 VW because it's overwriting this width right here because I don't want it to actually grow. So now as I scroll, you can see everything is still working exactly the same as it was before. And if I'm on a larger screen size, you can see it still grows from 50 to 100.